Nicole Mayhew. Welcome to News 6. Today's News 6 is being presented by Mrs. Mars and Mrs. Drewsbacki's 6th graders at Immaculate Conception Elementary School in Port Clinton, Ohio. Port Clinton attracts many tourists every year. Here with a story about what there is to see in Port Clinton is Darren Frawley.
Thank you, Nicole. Have you ever seen Canada's border, Catawba Island, Port Clinton, Kelly's Island, or Put-in Bay? All of these sites are on Lake Erie in the Port Clinton area. There are lighthouses and Perry's Monument to see. There are beaches, swimming, fishing, and boating. Port Clinton is the walleye capital of the world. Every year, people come from all parts of Ohio in the United States to spend the summer in cottages by the lake. During the winter, people go ice fishing, cross-country, skiing, and snowmobiling. A growing industry in Port Clinton is charter boat fishing. Over 200 people are now licensed charter boat captains by the Ohio Department of Natural Resources. Luke Zabel interviewed charter boat captain Tim McCann in Port Clinton.
Tim, could you tell us a little bit about charter boat fishing in Port Clinton?
The charter boat fishing season up here in Port Clinton usually begins about May and goes all the way through November. The fish we primarily go after in May and June and July are walleyes, and then the season progresses in August, September, and so on. We're all going for perch. There's good smallmouth fishing around the islands later on.
How do you know when the fish are biting?
Okay, usually every year at the same time, the walleyes, after they spawn, they come out of the river, and some of the fish that spawn out on the reefs, they usually don't start hitting until about May.
What is the biggest fish you ever saw caught?
The biggest fish we've had caught was an 11-pound, 3-ounce walleye that was caught 2 years ago by Captain Bob Sklarski.
How do you learn to be a charter boat captain?
You have to have 365 8-hour days, which usually takes a 4 to 5 year period of going out every day. You usually work underneath somebody until you have enough time, and then you can go up to the Coast Guard office and take an examination.
Thank you for the boat ride, Captain Tim.
You're welcome, Luke.
This is Luke Zabel for News 6.
Christmas is still more than a month away, but one Catawba Island woman and her children are already preparing for December 25th. Here with that story is Mirzi McClory.
While most people are preparing for Thanksgiving, one Catawba Island family is getting ready to decorate their Christmas tree. Mrs. Jackie Byro and her two children, Joe and Angela, started a collectible Ohio series of ornaments. Last year, it was decided that the first of the series would be the Ohio State bird, the cardinal. The ornaments are a white eyelet-edged pillow form with red velvet ribbon hangers. On the front is a cardinal on a pine branch. The back is decorated with a pine branch and dated 1980. All of the ornaments are signed Byro for the three artists that are creating them. Mrs. Byro has taught both Joe and Angela how to paint the beautiful little designs on the ornaments. This year's ornament is the second in the series and will be in the same design, but the state flower, the carnation, will be on the front of the ornament. On the back of the ornament, the flower will appear with the date. Mrs. Byro and her children also personalized some of the ornaments by painting the family members' names on the ornaments. The ornaments look beautiful on the tree. It is nice that a family can have a hobby that they can all work on together. Nicole?
Thanks, Mirzi. Ornament making could become a tradition in the Byro family. Another family in Port Clinton is carrying on a family tradition. Here with that story is Sean Podersky.
Thanks, Nicole. Many years ago, the grandfather of Kathy Coleman, one of our classmates, raised Belgian draft horses in the Oak Harbor, Ohio area. In fact, her grandfather had one of the last teams of workhorses in that part of Ohio. Today, Kathy's father, Calvin Coleman, carries on that tradition. He raises registered draft horses. Mr. Coleman helped his father take care of the horses when he was a child, and now Kathy helps her dad. These horses are used for plowing fields and pulling machinery. When this story was taped, a male named Kate had given birth to a new colt only 2 days earlier. Mr. Coleman said that He gets 8 to 10 colts every year. He usually has between 20 to 30 horses on his farm. He raises the horses and sells them, mostly the Amish communities that still use horses in their farming. These Belgian horses are one of the strongest and gentlest horses. Many people are now buying these horses to show. They are very big. The females weigh between 1,800 to 2,000 pounds. The males can weigh between 2,400 and 2,500 pounds. They are very beautiful animals. Nicole?
Thanks, Sean. You have probably heard of wine from France, Italy, and California, but how about wine from Ohio? Callie Michael has that story.
About 7,000 acres of grapes were planted along Lake Erie in the 1860s. Many of the grapes were planted by European immigrants. Wine was first made by a cooperative in 1870, and in 1872, work was begun on a four-tier limestone cellar that went 60 feet underground. The winery was purchased in 1956 by Norman Manty and was operated as a champagne cellar. Recently, another owner has taken over the business. News 6 took a tour of the winery, which was led by the terrific winemaster, Mr. Archie Stenson.
First, I would like to welcome you to the Monomy Wine Cellars and try to show you a little bit about how we do wine the old, old way and still doing many gallons per year the same way. You're standing now in our cask room, which is where all our dinner wines are made. And from here, we also make the cuvee for the champagne, which we'll show you later on the whole process.
How many gallons of wine are in these vats?
This floor alone will hold about 80,000 gallons.
What is happening in this room?
Okay, as you can see above, this is a cask of wine that's fermenting. If you see the little fermenting apparatus above, the gas is coming off into the jug of water. That acts as an air trap or an airlock. When the fermentation is done, no air can go back to spoil the wine. Also, it's a good indicator of when things are, what's happening up there, how fast, so forth and so on. Okay, now as we were talking above in our dinner wine cellar, and talk about the cuvee, from that point it's brought down here to make champagne. Now our method is made in the bottle the old French way. Now what we do, we take the wine, the cuvee, we add yeast, dosage, it's a sugar wine solution, to the cuvee, bring it down, put it in the bottle, and it ferments in the bottle. It looks like so. If you can see this sediment in the bottle there as this. And after a year on this lease or sediment, we have to get the sediment out. And to get this out into the neck, we first spin this and shake it loose back into solution. Once it's all broken loose, put the bottle neck down, which we'll show you later on in the reeling room. This will spiral its way down to the cap. Once it's compacted on the cap, a nice little wafer will freeze this into a plug of ice to get this out. Then open the cap. The pressure will push out the ice. The sediment is gone this way. The liquid stays this way. And at that point, the separation is made. Takes about 3 years from the grape to the shelf.
That's all for News 6 today. Next week's News 6 will be presented by Mrs. Smith's 6th grade class at Shawnee Junior High School in Fort Wayne, Indiana.